So why don't we get started? My name is David Wilkins. For those of you who don't know me or haven't been here before, I'm the faculty director of the Center on the Legal Profession at Harvard Law School. And this is our, it's an extended version, really, of our weekly speaker series that we have here, in which we try to bring interesting people who are doing interesting things in law around the world. And we're particularly focused on those important countries that are now reshaping our world, one of which, of course, is Brazil. One of our projects at the Center on the Legal Profession is called Globalization, Lawyers, and Emerging Economies, or GLEE, as we like to call it, which the young people here will know is a popular television show in the United States about a singing organization. I'm not going to sing and I don't wear a tracksuit, but what we do is to study how is globalization reshaping the market for legal services in the important new countries of the world, of which, of course, Brazil is one. We're also looking at India. We're also looking in China. And we are about to launch projects in Africa and the Middle East, and perhaps one in Eastern Europe and the former Soviet states as well. The goal is really to understand a simple to state but very complex phenomenon. So the GLEE project starts with the fact that in all of the countries that we're studying, around the 1990s, the country went through an important transition. And my guess is our guest speaker today will talk about that transition in Brazil. That transition is moving from a more or less closed economy and a closed governmental system, in Brazil's case, a system of military rule, to one that is more or less open to the world. And I want to emphasize more or less, because in each of the countries we're studying, it's a complex dynamic. And of course, no country is completely open to the world. All countries have their own forms of government in which they decide how much of the world to let in. But in Brazil, in India, in China, this phenomenon happens in the 1990s. And it results in many changes, but two that we focus on particularly in this project. One is it allows for the first time significant foreign direct investment into the country. And the second is that it results in the significant privatization of many previously state-owned assets. Again, neither is complete. There are interesting ways in which foreign direct investment and privatization have played out in each of the countries, but in each country, there's been a significant amount of both. That then has created a demand for new kinds of laws and legal institutions, which didn't exist previously. So suddenly you need a securities law, you need competition law, you need trade law, you need a variety of different kinds of institutions, both to regulate what's happening in the domestic economy, but also to interface between the domestic economy and the global economy and the global institutions like the WTO or like the IMF or like the World Bank. It doesn't take long before that demand and that transformation triggers another demand, which is for new or newly qualified lawyers who have the understanding and the skill of these new legal institutions and this new, increasingly global dynamic. The GLEE project really looks at how are each of the countries we're studying responding to that demand. In the simplest way, or the most direct way, this creates in each of the countries that we're looking at a new kind of or a new aspect of the legal profession that often either didn't exist before or was quite small. We call that the corporate legal sector or the corporate hemisphere. The most obvious manifestation of this is the development of law firms of increasing size and scale in each of these countries. Most of the countries we studied, you know, a large law firm might have had 20 or 30 lawyers tops, and most legal practitioners were really in solo or very, very small firms. Today, each of the countries we study, including Brazil, has very large law firms of several hundred lawyers. And it's not just law firms. The companies that have grown up in these jurisdictions now employ internally many lawyers. In fact, one of our projects, I was just in São Paulo last week, actually, on this very day. I was in São Paulo at a conference at FGV Law School in which we were speaking about these developments. And one of the things we're studying is the growth in the size and sophistication of internal legal departments in Brazil. And we're in the process, actually, of surveying both Brazilian countries and foreign multinational countries in Brazil. That's what you might think of as the kind of most obvious manifestation is you develop a kind of separate and distinctive corporate sector. But then the question is, what's the relationship between that sector and its development and other aspects of the Brazilian legal profession and Brazilian society more generally, and then even more generally, the institutions of global governance and the global legal profession? So if you think of GLE, it starts almost from a very large pebble being dropped into a stream, and then how those circles go out and change, for example, things like legal education. Or do they change traditional law firms or the Bar Association and its regulation? In fact, the congressman and I were just talking about OAB and the turmoil that there is in OAB about its regulation. Some of this has to do with this new globalized corporate sector that has been created. Or more relevant to what we're going to speak about today, how does it affect the institutions of government? And how does it affect what we might think of as the political economy of the country itself, its own institutions, its own way of governance? How is that affected by the introduction of this new category of lawyers? And just to be clear, they're not just domestic lawyers and domestic firms, but they're also international lawyers who increasingly want to serve the Brazilian market. And what's the conflict between those domestic lawyers and international lawyers? Again, that's one of the key issues, for example, facing OAB today. How does it affect the understanding of pro bono, public service, access to justice, and rule of law? Another issue we will talk a lot about today is exactly that. Brazil has had a long and rich tradition of understanding the relationship between lawyers and access to justice and the rule of law. How has that been affected by the creation of this new, increasingly globalized sector? Even the term pro bono has become one that's been interesting and controversial in the Brazilian context, again, within the context of the debate in OAB about whether pro bono is actually desirable or is it actually an infringement on the freedom and responsibilities of lawyers. And that's a debate I'm sure that we'll talk about here today. To study these questions, in each of the countries that we're looking at, we've put together a multinational, multi-institutional, and multidisciplinary team. So you cannot study these issues from afar or even by periodically visiting Brazil, as much fun as I love enjoying periodically visiting Brazil. You need to have people who really understand what's happening on the ground and what the local issues are. In Brazil, we have about 15 or so researchers, many of whom are associated with FGV, particularly the law school in Sao Paulo, although we also had people who were affiliated with the one in Rio, and other institutions in Brazil. And they come from different disciplines, not just law, but as Fabio here has a PhD in sociology, political science, economics, anthropology, because these are complex, multidimensional questions. And one of the things we hope to model here in the GLEE project is exactly that. For those of you who are law students here at Harvard or are coming from other jurisdictions, law is increasingly a multinational, multi-dimensional, multifaceted set of problems for which we need a broad range of skills for people who come from different professional backgrounds. Our goal is to both create knowledge about Brazil, and we now have about 10 different studies, all of which are empirical, built from the ground up. So we don't start with theory and go to the facts. We try to build the theory from the facts, from what we can understand on the ground on the basis of empirical research. The studies have been pulled together in a book form that will hopefully be published by Cambridge University Press. Cambridge University Press is already publishing the book that we're doing on India and seems interested in the whole series. So I hope the next time we're together, we'll actually have a book for you that you'll be able to have a chance to take a look at. But we view the book as really the beginning, not the end of the project, because the phenomena we're studying are ongoing and continue to touch a broad range of issues that are really even beyond the core dimension of the GLEE project. And that really is what brings us today to the event that you are all here with us and to our featured speakers. As everybody, I think, in this room knows, whether you are Brazilian or you are just interested in Brazil, this is a time of tremendous challenge for Brazil. There are many things that are going on, both politically and economically. And the issues that we've studied in the GLEE project, we think are relevant to those set of issues. But of course, they're only one part of a much more complex story. In the course of studying in Brazil, and I've now been to Brazil probably, I don't know, 7 or 8 times in the last several years. Again, I would love to go there many more if anybody would like to invite me. But I've had the chance to meet many people who have then introduced us to people who are also grappling with this set of questions. So one is Bruno Barata, who's sitting over here, who's a distinguished lawyer in Rio de Janeiro, works both in the city government as well as in his own law firm. And we met in the context of my coming over to do research in Brazil, and then he was very kind to invite me to be one of, I think, the very few non-Brazilians to ever address a national congress of the OIB, which I did last year. And then he said to me that he knew the congressman and that the congressman was working on some of the issues that were relevant to the issues that I've discussed, and that the congressman might be coming to the United States and would be willing to engage with students here and with others in our community in a robust and open-minded debate about some of the issues happening in Brazil. I said that would be a terrific experience and opportunity for our students and for our wider community. And the congressman was very gracious enough to agree to accept the invitation and to come to speak. So the way we're going to do this is I'm now going to get out of the way, having introduced the session. And we're going to first hear from Congressman Leonardo Picciani, and I hope I pronounced this at least approximately correct, Congressman, who is A very important figure in Brazilian politics, as many of you may know. He was first elected as congressman in 2002. For those of you who are students and think that, oh, well, I'm young, I have a lot of time to make my mark, he was 23 years old when he was first elected to the Brazilian Congress. He's in, I think, his fourth term, which would allow you to figure out how old he is, which is still young. And he's the chair of the Constitution and Justice and Citizenship Commission of the House of Representatives. And he's also the rapporteur of the Parliamentary Commission on Inquiry on Privacy and many other features. The congressman has agreed to give us a brief presentation on the Brazilian political system, which he will start in just a minute. But he has assured me that what he's really most interested in doing is to have a very open and vigorous debate about not only the issues he's discussing, but what's happening in Brazil today, which I know many of you are very interested in. But before we open it up for discussion, our amazing postdoctoral fellow, Fabio De Sa e Silva, who is spending a year with us, is going to give some remarks both on the project that he's doing for GLEE, which is around the transformation. He's really doing two projects for GLEE, actually, I should say. One is around the transformation of pro bono and public service and how it's being affected by this new globalized corporate sector, as I mentioned before. But also, he's working with David Trubeck, who many of you may know, on another project looking at how is this new globalized corporate sector transforming the political economy inside of Brazil, particularly with respect to the telecom sector, where he just got back. And when I say just got back, his cab arrived from the airport from Brazil at 11:45. So I think we should be especially grateful for Fabio, who has flown straight back from Sao Paulo here to be with us to talk about these subjects. So the congressman will go first, then Fabio will offer some reflections, and then we will open it up to all of you, and we look forward to your comments, questions, and ideas. Thank you very much. Congressman Picciani.
Thank you, Professor Wilkins. It's a great honor to be here to say thanks to the invitation. To stay to talk about the Brazil with Fabio Silva. And say thanks to Mr. Bruno Barata, a great friend and a great Brazilian lawyer. When I was invited to talk here about the Brazilian perspectives, I decided to talk about the political system and the political reform. In the last decades, since the 90s, in Brazil, the political reforms is called mother of all reforms. There are a consensus that without a deep political reform, the country cannot do other important reforms, like taxes reforms, labor law reform, and other reforms that it's important to Brazil, especially in this moment. At first, I may apologize about my English. There are a long time that I don't use English language often. So I can show you an overview about the Brazilian political system. The Brazilians here know this very well, but I think for others, very interesting to have an overview about the country, and you can do a discussion, and after I will be available to answer the questions and doubts you have. So. Can it start very quickly? It's not too long. But Brazilian, like U.S., is a bicameral system with the House of Representatives, called in Portuguese Câmara dos Deputados, Chamber of Deputies. We have 513 representatives. And in the Senate, we have 81 senators, three for each state. In Brazil, we have 27 states, 26 plus the federal district, the Brazilian. It's similar to the US system, a bicameral too. And we have the unique characteristics. Of the Brazilian parliament, and the most important thing to be discussed in the political reforms is the power fragmentation. In Brazil, there are 35 parties, political parties, and 28 elect at least one representative in the 2014 election. The three biggest parties, my part, the PMDB, the PT, the government part, the workers' part, now in government, and the PSDB, Social Democratic part, is the opposition biggest part. All the two biggest part together, all together, respond to 1/3 of all representatives. In Brazil, different the US, there are compulsory vote for all the people older than 18 years, less than 70. There are some similarities between Brazil and North American models. The number of voters is similar. Brazil have 140 million voters, in US about 200 voters. An attempt to vote in session in 2014, we had 115 million. The vote is mandatory, it's compulsory. In US about 130 million. The elections is simultaneous right here for the other public offices. But there are some difference between the two models. The presidential elections is different in Brazil. The model in Brazil is different from US. Now in Brazil, the vote is direct in the candidate. In the pre-campaign, and there are no. In the pre-campaign, is interpartidary, is not in the whole society. There are no electoral college, is directly vote in the first turn. If no one candidate has the majority, you have a second turn, 2 weeks after. Between the two must vote candidates. We have in Brazil the TV propaganda, free airtime campaign on TV and radio. It's prohibited to buy additional minutes in the radio or television. It's a strong difference from here. And we have the system of the electronic vote. I think it's the only one country in the world. All voters have cast their votes in the electronic vote machine. It's since 2000. Since 2000, all Brazilian voters use the electronic machine to vote. It's the results are available in few years. In few hours. It's very quick to know the results. In this year, in the discussion of political reform, the Congress Chamber of Deputies and the House of Representatives and the Senate approved the impression of the votes. But it was vetted by the President Dilma Rousseff, maybe today the VAT will be discussed in the in Brazilian Congress. The argument to VAT was the big costs. It's estimated in 1.8 billions of Brazilian reals. In the electoral justice, invest in the another ways of make it secure, make it the other subject about the political reforms. How can I say? In the last years, the people pointed out as the mother of all reforms. There's a consensus in the society, in the parliament. It's needed of a broad and definitive political reforms. The central themes dominated the recent debates in legislative was the electoral system, incorporate campaign funding. I will talk later about the corporate campaign fund. But the electoral system, the whole Brazilian system is majority vote for elector the president, the governors, the mayors, and the senators. Even for the representatives, the system is proportional. It's an open list proportional system. It was important for the country in other times, in other moments from the country. It was the Brazilian system since 1932, the proportional open list. But now I think it's the cause of the power fragmentation and the illegitimacy of the mandate. Because people vote in one candidate and another be elected for the mandate. It's normal the parties invited some strongly known people like famous actors, famous athletes to be candidate. They are strongly known by the society, have a big number of votes, and then elect another candidates without a expressly number of votes. So the people don't understand well about this, don't accept well about this. How can vote in candidate and elect another? So it's in the power fragmentation. To the government to have majority or to have consensus is very difficult in a scenario like this. 28 parties represented in the Congress. It's difficult to have agreement about the important themes, the important things, and make change, and make deep change, and make strong change. So my party defended in the last, in this year, in the last vote about the political reforms, another system, a majority voting system. It's called in Portuguese, called distritão. It's a system when the candidate in each state will be elected by the number of votes. So the most voted will be elected. No, without the coefficient electoral for each party or each party alliance. It's another distortion of Brazilian system, because the parties can do the party alliance to the proportional elections. So the elector votes in candidate from one party and elect a candidate for another party. And sometimes parts with completely different views, completely different programs, and completely different ideology, completely different ideology from network. This one I'm talking about, the electoral system and the distortion, less than 10% of current federal representatives received enough individual votes to be elected. For example, in my state, the Rio de Janeiro state, there are 46 representatives. It's the third biggest college in Brazil, São Paulo, Minas Gerais, and then Rio de Janeiro. Only five candidates received enough votes to be elected directly, without the quotient. I was one of them. I was the 50 in the general number of vote for. I'm the last to be have the directed elected. The other 41 was elected by the coefficient, the electoral coefficient. But the consequence I told you, the electors' frustrations, the question of legitimacy of the political representation. So my conclusion is the cause adopted since 1932, the open list proportional election system for congressmen is the key to this frailty. Now in this, you can see the fragmentation here. This table shows the great fragmentation that I mentioned before. There are 28 parties with representatives elected in the House of Representatives. In the election, PT has the largest number of seats and has representatives elected in 21 units of the federation. My party, the PMDB, is the only party that has representatives in all states, in all the countries, the second in number of seats. And the PSDB is the biggest oppositional parties. There are 54 representatives in 23 states of 27 states. So you can see how difficult it is make some agreements, make some governability, and is a strong work to the government has governability in the Congress. It's very, very difficult. Regarding about the corporate funding, it's a strong the donations to campaign. A recent ruling of the Brazilian Supreme Court prohibits corporate funding of electoral campaigns. It's a great innovation. It's a lawsuit by the Brazilian Bar Association in the Supreme Court, and by eight votes to three, the Supreme decided to prohibit the donations, the corporate donations to campaign. It's not in Brazil the public funds is prohibited to use in the campaigns. But there are two mechanisms to do this. The party's fund is a public fund that finances the party's activities. And their time and the free TV and radio propaganda was paid by the taxes in exemptions for the TV channels and the radio channels. Until 2014, campaigns could donate directly to electoral companies. Could donate directly to electoral campaigns. The prohibition is already on for next year, 2016, municipal electors, and we'll see how it will work. I think it's very very radical decision. It's not my personal view. I think it will be a strong problem because we will have without funding elections. You know, we can use public funds, and we can use the company's donations. So I think only the private donations will not work. It's a small part of the funding. So I think then we'll see next year how it will work. And the Congress, the Congress approved an amendment to allow the company's funding to the campaigns, but not voted. It approved by the House of Representatives and is in the agenda, the Senate agenda, but not voted yet. It's possible on a constitutional change in next year. So I talk about the major points, the majority vote in my part in defense. It was debated in the House of Representatives, but don't have votes enough to be approved. There are several proposed to change the proportional open list, but don't have any. This proposed have majority to be approved. I think the majority vote, there are some main advantages. Prevent electors from electing that they hadn't voted for. It brings the electors closer to representatives. It favors governability. The House of Representatives reject other proposals and kept the open list proportional election. There are many others proposals, closed list, proportional voting. I think that's a system more closer than the parliamentarism system. It's a closer list. A mixed member proportional system, half of the seats are filed by a closed list in a proportional vote, and the other half by majority vote in districts in a system like a U.S. system, majority vote in districts. And another thing that don't have majority, and I personally defend, is the voluntary vote. I think the voluntary voting is the best system because it make the parties and the electors are closer. The parties and the candidates have to be close the voters to make them go to the elections and decide to vote. So I think it's better. Brazil is one of the few countries where the vote is not voluntary. It's mandatory, so it's we lost an opportunity to change. It's not easy to make these modifications. Okay, and I said the Senate will discuss the proposal for amendment constitutional approved by the House of Representatives, which talks about the political reforms of party fidelity, with print and vote, and the simplification of popular initiative of law. Now it's necessary 1.4 million signatures to a directly project of law, and this proposal reduced to 500,000 signatures. But deadlock in the approval of profound reforms has led to some alterations in the infra-constitutional legislation. That's why they are called mini electoral reforms. In the past 10 years, there have been 4 mini electoral reforms. The objective of all these reforms is reduce the costs of the campaigns, reduce the spending of money in the campaigns. Now, in this law, it will vetted 2 points vetted by the president, the corporate donations to campaigns. The Congress approved in the infra-constitutional law the authorization to the campaigns to do donations. But after the Supreme Court decision, the president decided to veto this law too, in the printing of vote. The change proposed by the mini reform, there are typo. Here's a duration of electoral campaign. It went down from 9 to 45 days. The objective of this is reduce costs, make it more cheap, the campaigns more cheap, reduce to the airtime on television, down from 45 to 35 days, and spend it to an electoral campaign. They now have limits. They have 70% of the cost of the last election. Is the maximum. And there will be a bigger transparency in disclosure of donation received. Now the candidate and the parties in 72 hours has to inform who is the financing, who is the donor of the resource. It have be disponible in the internet and before the electoral justice in 72 hours. Public funding. I thought that the campaigns not receive public money. However, there are two mechanisms of injection of public funding in the electoral activities: party funding, free campaign time. The campaigns, I told, the Brazilian Supreme Court considering constitutional the ruling on corporate donation to the campaign. On public fund, also integrate the new legislation, but the president vetoed it after Supreme Court's ruling. The proposal for a constitutional amendment is to be discussed at the Senate. The proposal has already been approved by the House of Representatives. This amendment allows corporate funding parties. In Brazil, there are limits for individual donation. The voters' donation are limited to 10% of the income earned in the year prior to the election. In a contrary way, in 2014, the U.S. Supreme Court overthrew the limit for voters' financial contributions of campaign. The principle argument for the Brazilian Supreme Court ruling is that the companies funding for the campaigns disrespect the autonomy between the candidates. Between the candidates. So the, my conclusions, the agreement on how to implement a new system of elections for representatives, a great opportunity has been lost to address critical aspects of the Brazilian political system, especially the lack of legitimacy of political representation, the undesirable fragmentation of power in parliament, and the difficulty of each government to compose its support bases. Campaigns, recent changes in legislation brought little progress related to the campaign costs, reduction of campaign period, decrease in time of free campaign TV time, and limited costs by candidates. And corporate funding, corporate donation are the main source of campaigns traditionally. The 2016 municipal elections will show how the candidates will behave in face of this important restriction. It's completely new. It's completely new. But there is a consensus in Brazil about the need of political reform, but which reform? Each party, its representative, its senator has one reform in mind. So it's difficult to have agreement. In the discussion of the detail, there is a lack of agreement. Many representatives tend to hesitate in reforming the system that got them elected. It's a conservative option. Major in the last times when the Brazilian Congress talked about the political reforms, the majority have option for a conservative view, and decide to kept the system actual. And how can I say at the beginning? I think it's the most important reform in Brazil, because all other reforms that depends the law changes, depends the action of the Congress, need a political reform to have a party more quiet, more stable, stable situation in the political parties. So I think it's important point. It's about the Brazilian political reforms, and I am available to answer the questions after Fabio comments.
Thank you very much, Congressman.
Thank you, Fabio. Thank you.
So thanks, Dave, for this chance, but especially for keeping a continued interest in Brazil. I think, especially at a critical time like this, it's important for us to know that people are following what's going on in the country at institutions like Harvard and the Center of the Legal Profession, which is, at the end of the day, a recognition of the important role that Brazil plays in the global, both in terms of development and in terms of global governance and others. This is actually the second time that I am invited to speak about Brazil generally, beyond my own research and my expertise. The first one was in 2010, when we had a meeting here of the GLEE project, and David Trubeck took the advantage of that to organize a panel on Brazil and the Brazilian development model. And I point that out because it's two radically different moments that we lived in 2010 and now. And there was a time when I was, one of the works that I was doing back in Brazil was to edit a book about democracy and development. And there was a book that was published by IPEA, the research institute that I'm part of, and was produced with contribution of probably the leading figures in political science and social sciences in Brazil. So we invited all of them for a conversation about the Brazilian democracy and how that might relate to development. And we had a very broad understanding of democracy in the context of that conversation. What these authors refer to when they speak of democracy is more than representation or just the ballot box. It also involves participatory institutions and mechanisms of public and social accountability. And we also had a very optimistic analysis. If the country was having a moment of economic growth, social inclusion, and democracy, three things that are very different to come together. I mean, if we keep ourselves limited to the countries that we've been studying, the GLEE project, I think that Brazil was probably the most successful in combining the three. It didn't grow like China, but it's a democratic country. It didn't grow like India, but it has much more equality and it has achieved much more equality in this time period. And in terms of democracy itself, we had a very optimistic analysis too. We thought that these three systems, representation, participation, and accountability, they were interconnected and they were generating positive results for the country, and therefore reinforcing the process of development. This all comes from the studies that these people were doing for 20 or 30 years since the 1988 Constitution. But the conclusion at that time in 2010 was that despite the fact that the party system in Brazil is fragmented, the governments had been able to create consensus and to create a developmental agenda. So in the 90s, we have the economy stabilized, the inflation brought down, and in the 2000s, we had this process of inclusion and also some process of institutional development affecting other sectors of the government, like courts and the Ministério Público. So our idea in 2010 was that the country was having a virtual cycle between democracy and development, with democracy broadly understood reinforcing the development process. And now it seems that we are kind of losing both democracy and development, right? Development because all of those results, economic growth, social inclusion, are sort of threatened by what we call the crisis these days, and democracy because all of these three pillars of our democratic system, representation, participation, and accountability, they're kind of disbalanced and dysfunctional, right? So the congressman talked about this growing feeling that representation is weak. So the relationship between voters and the elected politicians is felt as weak. Participation, we had in 2014 the decree 8243 signed by the president, trying to strengthen participatory institutions within the government, and that was heavily attacked by the opposition and by some media figures. So this, people began to say that participatory institutions were Bolivarian institutions, right? Those of you who are from Latin America, you know what that means. It's an attempt to discredit these experiments that have been in place since the 1980 Constitution in Brazil by associating it with the Venezuelan regime. And in terms of public and social accountability, although the institutions are working, there may be a feeling or a fear that they now are concentrating too much power, or that people are relying too much on these institutions. For example, the government, the congressman told about the Supreme Court prohibiting corporate funding to political campaigns, and people ask whether that was a job for the Supreme Court to do or not. Although that can be framed in terms of rights, it's always preferable that the Congress is able to discuss and deliberate about that. But also in terms of the courts and the Court of Accounts and the Ministerio Público, all of those have become fora for political issues. So now there's a lawsuit pending against Dilma at the Superior Electoral Court, the Supreme Electoral Court, with which the opposition, you know, expects to impeach her, so to speak. There is a, you know, part of the political issues have been transferred to the TCU, the Court of Accounts, and the Lava Jato operation that's carried out by the Ministerio Público and the Federal Police is kind of shaking the political system too. So, so these three pillars, as I said, some of them are becoming dysfunctional, and some of them are maybe becoming disbalanced in their importance. For the function of the democratic system as a whole. Now, we can see that as an episodical moment. So we can see that as, to use Kuhn's term, as a crisis of growth. That means that after a few months or years, these institutions are going to find their best way to contribute to the democratic experience, and start to produce good policies and good things for the country. Or we can see that as a crisis of degeneration, like Kuhn said, which means that some of them will need to go through deep reforms. And I think I'm not inclined to one way or the other. I think that we can have some reforms are certainly necessary, and political reform is certainly necessary. Although I disagree from the congressman with the solutions that he proposed, but I think there's a bigger issue here, and this is where I think it makes sense to connect to our research on the Brazilian legal profession. And I'm going to tell just a little bit of what we found in this research. This, as David said, was a research about the changes in the corporate legal sector in Brazil after the 90s. All of what we had about that subset of the Brazilian legal profession was produced 20 or 30 years ago. And the narrative was that globalization was taking place. These firms and lawyers were being challenged to reinvent themselves, but they were not doing, they were not meeting those expectations. And the book that Yves Dezalane and Brian Garth write in the early 2000s, they point out that only Pinheiro Neto was a firm that was, you know, becoming able to speak to the needs of these foreign clients and mediate those global transactions. And 30 years after that, when we did our research, we were, you know, positively surprised, because the legal market in Brazil has become much more sophisticated. These firms are now, they all have very modern structures and practices. But what we also saw was that this change was limited to the economic organization of the firms in terms of the political and social roles that these firms could be playing in Brazil. We found very little. And the two examples were, as David mentioned, pro bono. We didn't see firms committed with doing anything for the society at large, and in terms of gender, which was also a study that we did. So we saw a lot of gender inequality in these firms, and no policies, no real intent to change that. Quite the opposite, we really saw machist discourses in the meeting that we had with the firm people in São Paulo last week. So this made us put two questions on the table as we gathered last week in São Paulo. The first was this, right? Why did we have this limited change just confined to the economic organization of the firms and not reaching the public and social role that we expect that lawyers play in especially in countries that are developing. And the second question that we posed was whether this was not a microcosm of the Brazilian society and whether we have an elite that's self-serving and that is not capable to produce the kinds of consensus that are needed for the country to evolve. So I don't want to put this as a question. I just want to put this as a reflection because I think that part of the problems that the congressman points out to is a result of that, is a result of the lack of ability of our elite, of our elites to really show commitment to some dimensions of the country's development and transform that into institutions that could foster that kind of development. And he mentions the political reform. I have no reason to disagree from that. But I also think that media reform is an important issue in Brazil. And part of the distortions in the media system is actually what feeds the power of local politicians at the state and local levels. But again, I don't know if we can realistically expect that these changes are going to take place, because you know what we see now is a lack of leadership everywhere, and maybe he, as a young politician, could address this and speak about how he sees people in his generation being capable to overcome this in the future, because I don't want to go back to Brazil to do research in Brazil 30 years from now and find out that we still have a long way to go in issues like those, political reform, media reform, just because we still have an elite that's self-serving and not committed to broader change. Thank you.
Thank you, Fabio. Thank you for both speakers. So the floor is open, and the congressman said he may answer in Portuguese, and Bruno or others or Fabio will help to translate. Please, yes.
And in Brazil, very few entities have standing to file class actions. And because of that, the Bar Association is against class action every time it has the opportunity to say something. So my question is, isn't it the time that we should consider changing our class action system to give standing to people and also involving lawyers as they are involved here in the United States so that it would add to our democracy?
Thank you.
So, você quer pegar uma sequência, talvez três, e aí responde?
Como for melhor? Não sei se você quer.
We're just debating whether it's better to have a sequence like two or three, and then.
Okay, why don't we
yeah.
do that? But we promise we'll get back to it because I think both of them have something interesting to say about that. So please hear, and then sure.
Yeah,
oh, you want to go first? Okay, all right. It's a very polite crowd.
So thank you for your remarks. So I guess my question is, you mentioned Congressman and Paul Beauty. And one of the reasons why it's so hard to do that in Brazil is because of the implementation of the political system. But even considering that, when we think that representatives of the Labor Party are not voting together some issues that are very relevant to the future of the Brazilian economy and the political scene as a whole. My question to you is, how should we expect a different outcome from the political system with the implementation of reform that would, in one way, increase the ability of the parties to build consensus in the sense that we have less parties at stake, but at the same time, congressmen would have the ability to vote against orientation of the parties. So I guess my question is, should we be expecting a whole different outcome of this reform when currently the congressmen of the Labour Party are not willing to vote with the president that was elected from the Labour Party?
Why don't we take one more question and then we'll let the panelists
answer.
Is that okay, Fabio?
I think my question goes in the same way. I'm very happy to have like a young congressman preoccupied to solve some problems, and we agree with the problems, like one of them, fragmentation of our electoral system. But I'm quite skeptical about the solution of a uninominal district to solve that. That's one reason. It can strengthen fragmentation instead of diminish it, because we're going to empower the individuals against the institutions, the parties. And you also mentioned ways to make campaigns cheaper. And if we consider that the candidate has a whole state as a district, it can make more expensive to travel throughout the state and so on. By the way, the proposal of your party was defeated. And in the previous years, the proposal of the Workers' Party, like the vote list, was also defeated. So we have as a politician, maybe you are used to make second best solutions. And we have in the table one other proposal. That's the mixed proportional system. The original proposal of Social Democratic Party. Mm-hmm. And some leaders of the Workers' Party agreed to discuss that possibility. My question would be, why not you in the good position you are, like a leader of the party, can think about the second best solution with the Workers' Party and the Social Democratic Party?
So why don't we start with you, and you can address some of those things, and if we don't have everything,
yep.
Tá, então a primeira questão foi sobre legitimidade das ações, propostas de ações coletivas, né, que se não seria o caso de aumentar essa legitimidade como uma forma de promover a democracia, dando oportunidade para mais pessoas ou organizações discutirem políticas públicas no judiciário e também envolver os advogados na promoção da democracia. A segunda pergunta é como é que a gente pode esperar um resultado diferente, tendo em vista que parlamentares não... votam com partidos e aí você dá o exemplo do PT, né, que enfim, tem votado contra algumas orientações do partido, que também é governo, aí até deixa a situação um pouco mais dramática. E terceiro, quer dizer, apoiada nessa questão, é sobre se o distritão não pode aumentar a fragmentação e, além disso, gerar custos maiores, porque o candidato vai ter que viajar pelo estado todo, né, e aí ele pergunta a sua posição sobre o distrital misto, se você não enxerga nisso uma solução alternativa, já que tanto o distritão quanto a lista fechada estão...
Thank you, Tom.
Eu acho que os três são brasileiros.
Isso.
Eu vou responder aqui em... Não, com relação às ações coletivas, eu acho que quanto mais tiver, melhor. Eu acho que é uma coisa que tem... funcionado, a maioria dessas ações sobre questão eleitoral foram propostas pela própria OAB, por algumas outras, as mais importantes pela OAB, com certeza. Eu acho que pode aumentar. Há em contrações uma preocupação com algo que tem ocorrido muito, que é a judicialização da política. Num determinado nível, também não é desejável que haja uma judicialização muito grande da política.
Mas, deputado, será que o Ministério Público já não faz isso?
Já faz. Eu entendi. Que os advogados participassem mais, tivessem.
Porque
eu
acho que eles podem
melhor essa eu concordo com você. Acho que a OAB, ela, que foi um papel que a OAB historicamente exerceu, sobretudo no período militar, no período da redemocratização, e que ela, apesar do ativismo em algumas questões, tem deixado de lado, porque eu concordo que a OAB precisa ser. Eu conversava com o professor Wilkins antes sobre a discussão que tem a respeito do papel da OAB, da inclusão dos advogados. Eu penso que isso tudo faz parte de uma necessária mudança, na OAB e em outras instituições, mesmo no movimento sindical, em outros movimentos, uma participação mais direta e mais associativa das pessoas.
Na verdade, eu não tinha nem em mente a OAB. Eu tinha em mente a pessoa física, mesmo advogado.
Exatamente.
Fortalecer a classe,
não
a instituição, a classe.
O que era exatamente o sujeito da nossa discussão. É que no Brasil isso acaba ficando muito engessado pelo papel que a OAB tem. A OAB está na Constituição, então ela acaba exercendo uma regulamentação, com muito cuidado nessa afirmação, mas até de certo ponto excessiva na regulação da profissão e da atuação dos advogados, bacharéis, das pessoas, dos operadores de direito.
So just to translate, regarding the first question about the standing for class actions, he agrees that it could be expanded. He just fears that, he just thinks that we need to be careful about that because there can be an excessive judicialization of politics as a result of that. And then they discussed a little bit about the terms of this and the role of the bar vis-a-vis individual lawyers, etc.
Did you want to say anything about that, or Minister?
No, I mean, let the yeah. We have a few minutes.
So
outra sobre o PT, e distritão, se quiser trabalhar junto.
As perguntas são parecidas, mas eu creio que com relação ao distritão. É importante entender na prática como funciona. Por que eu acho que não aumenta a fragmentação? Que hoje o candidato ele busca um partido em que ele possa se eleger com menos voto, com votação menor. Nós tivemos assim uma loucura total de um determinado partido, pegou o seu tempo na televisão e fez uma propaganda dizendo o seguinte: se filia ao nosso partido, que nas últimas eleições o nosso partido foi o que elegeu os candidatos menos votados. Então, se monta uma estrutura, pela regra do jogo, que o candidato tenta se eleger. No distritão, como teria que ter o voto, independente do partido que ele estivesse, evidentemente que ele procuraria um partido mais forte para ser candidato. Seria, na sua maioria, candidato pelos partidos maiores, mais fortes. E com outro detalhe, esses partidos, ao invés também de terem que fazer uma legenda, uma nominata, lançar vários candidatos apenas para somar no coeficiente eleitoral, eles poderiam lançar um número menor de candidatos, por isso, e, portanto, selecionar melhor esses candidatos dentro do partido. Com relação à dificuldade dos partidos seguirem, ele advém justamente desse sistema. Como, na verdade, cada um se elege por conta própria, na hora de votar, ainda mais quando se trata de reforma política, ele vota de forma muito individual. E, na maioria das vezes, pensando assim, vou votar dessa forma, que é a forma que eu me elegi, então, se assim está dando certo, por que eu vou mudar essa direção.
And what about the second best solution?
Ah, okay, the circumvent solution. I think there are two problems in the in this second best solution, the missed. Né? O primeiro delas é o seguinte, você tem... você acaba tendo os problemas dos dois sistemas. Qual é o problema da lista fechada? É que ele é um sistema muito próximo do parlamentarismo. Os países que adotam listas fechadas são países parlamentaristas, em que o próprio primeiro-ministro advém da lista. Isso legitima. Eu não sei, num presidencialismo quase imperial que a gente tem no Brasil, como é que a gente teria um presidente eleito com milhões de votos e um Congresso eleito sem voto direto, né, ou sem representação direta, uma representação. E o segundo problema é que a própria estrutura dos partidos no Brasil, que são bastante cartoriais, e aí como é que você iria transferir a disputa para as convenções partidárias? Eu acho que aí, por exemplo, o poder econômico ia poder influir muito mais. Você imagina, você pode influir numa eleição com milhões de eleitores, você imagina numa convenção com 200 delegados, 300 delegados, a força que o poder econômico não teria na composição das listas. Com relação ao distrito, nós temos eu particularmente gosto do sistema distrital, chamado distrital puro, né, distrital unitário. Acho que aproxima o eleitor. Mas no Brasil você tem dois problemas com relação a isso. Um de ordem prática, que é como é que se dividiriam esses distritos. Você tem uma dificuldade enorme de fazer essa divisão, sobretudo por causa do norte e nordeste, que perderia muita representatividade na composição do Congresso. E é difícil, porque hoje eles têm a maioria da representação, então eles não obstaculizam esse tipo de mudança. Outra dificuldade do distrital puro é que, só preciso dizer que nós vamos eleger vários vereadores federais. Você ia acabar prejudicando determinados candidatos com voto de opinião. Porque os candidatos que normalmente são até os mais votados na eleição, mas eles acabam sendo espalhados por toda a área em que se disputa voto. Quando fosse para o distrito, talvez ele perdesse para um líder comunitário com uma atuação mais local. Então, o sistema misto ele até preveniria um pouco isso, né? Porque quem tem voto de opinião iria para a lista, quem tem voto de representação local iria para o distrito. Mas tem esses problemas, muito embora eu particularmente não goste da lista e particularmente goste do distrital.
So this is a very technical discussion, very hard to translate. But he...
It's difficult for me to say in English.
So he was... he was basically backing up his opinions about the virtues of the district-based election system, electoral system that he presented. So one thing he mentioned is just generally he. O primeiro argumento que você falou foi do rebatendo a questão do distritão, né?
Porque o voto em lista ele é muito próximo do parlamentarismo. Então você teria um presidente eleito com a legitimidade de milhões de votos e um congresso eleito sem voto direto, que reduziria muito a...
Tem alguma coisa que você acha que eu tenho que destacar? Porque, enfim... Eu tô realmente muito confuso sobre como fazer. I'm very confused about translating this because it's a very technical. But he's kind of comparing the different models, and he believes that the American style with the individual district would be technically good, but it has we would have problem transporting that to the Brazilian reality, and at the same time,
it's an important point. The distro system works very well in US, as you have two parties.
Yeah. Not 35.
And I think he also stressed that he doesn't believe that this would create fragmentation, more than what we have. It would be a different rationale for the election that he believes would make the elected the group of people who would be elected by the same party more cohesive. I don't know. I mean, it's very hard. I'm sorry about this.
Okay. Other questions or comments from the audience, please.
Actually, he confessed that he committed domestic violence with his former wife. And my question is, if you believe that he is able to govern a city which has more than 100 cases of domestic violence per day, that's it.
You understand the question?
Yes, I understand. Where are you from?
Actually, I'm from Bahia, but I'm
Are you Brazilian?
Yeah, I've been okay. For the past 10 years, so it is a city that I care very much, that I love very much, and I'm really worried about this particular issue.
Okay, I ask, so it's responding in Portuguese, I think it's better.
Yes,
perfect. Bom, primeiro, ela faz uma pergunta, é um caso muito específico de um membro do meu partido, que provavelmente será o candidato a prefeito do Rio de Janeiro, que estaria envolvido num episódio de violência doméstica com a ex-mulher, né? Evidentemente, você tem um procedimento, há um inquérito em curso, né, conduzido pelo Ministério Público, pelo Procurador-Geral da República, uma vez que ele tem a prerrogativa de foro por ser deputado federal. Houve recentemente uma manifestação conjunta dele e da ex-mulher em que eles admitem os episódios de agressão mútua, mas tanto ela quanto ele fazem a ressalva de que essa não era, embora o casamento não tenha dado certo, essa não era a vida cotidiana do casal, foi um episódio isolado. Ela faz uma referência de que ele não é uma pessoa, não é nem nunca foi durante o casamento, uma pessoa agressiva. Evidentemente que não há justificativa para nenhum tipo de violência, seja enfim, qualquer violência não se justifica. Então, eu creio que uma importante evolução do Brasil é que o país vive um momento de regularidade institucional, não só para esse episódio, mas como diversos outros episódios. Ou seja, as instituições têm funcionado. Então, quem tem que investigar, investiga. Quem tem que acusar, acusa. Quem foi acusado pode se defender, e a justiça, ao final, julga e esclarece. De modo que eu penso que esse episódio, ele, sem dúvida nenhuma, será muito debatido. Ele é um episódio grave, com extrema gravidade, mas eu creio até que, pelo princípio, né, da presunção da inocência, pelo princípio da ampla defesa, você deve aguardar o desfecho do inquérito que está em andamento. Se ele virar uma denúncia e for acatado pelo judiciário, do desfecho do processo. Eu não faço, nesse caso específico, nenhum tipo de pré-julgamento, muito embora eu, evidentemente, considere um caso com grande gravidade. At this moment, yes. How can I say? It's not finished. The procedure, the procedure is not finished. The investigation is in the course. And so after this, the part we have to discuss this. It will be discussed at the moment, because the nomination is just in August next year. Now there are no nomination, but in the correct moment, obviously, it will be discussed.
So that was the core of his response previously. He said that there is an investigation about the potential candidate, and in light of due process rights, he believes that we need to wait for that to be completed. And he also pointed out there was a public statement made by the potential candidate and his wife, admitting that there was some conflict and violence, but claiming that that was episodic. I just wanted to follow on a point that he made about PT not voting with the president. Of course, that's a reflect that reflects what goes on with the Brazilian political system. I just think that we need to understand that in the broader context that I mentioned in my brief remarks, in terms of the political elites in the country not being able to come up with a project for our development in the near future. Clearly, the reason why people elected Dilma was not to do some things that she's doing. And of course, she could construe that with the people and convince them about the need for this in order for her to make to produce the results that she promised in the campaign. I think there's clearly a lack of leadership from her part in terms of, you know, bringing the country together around that agenda and placing that agenda in the context of her promises in the campaign. But I also think she's not the one who is failing here. I think what the opposition is doing in terms of pursuing the impeachment as a political agenda, regardless of whether there is or not proof.
And voting against the
measures that they should be much more inclined to support. I think that also hurts a lot, you know, the democratic system and creates an even bigger separation between voters and the people they elect. So, I wish we will have that overcome according to the rules of the game during her term. I don't know how, but I wish the political elites are going to be able to find a way out of this.
Well, listen, this has been a very robust discussion, and these are obviously very big issues, but I want to thank the congressman and Fabio for helping to put them on the table for all of us. And I hope it's a conversation we can continue. And I promise both of you that this is by far not the end of my engagement with Brazil, a country I first visited in 1971, including Bahia, which is one of my favorite places in the world, before almost anybody in the room was born. I'm looking at one gentleman that maybe he and I were here in 1971, but we intend to stay engaged, both as a center and to bring the kind of robust and important dialogue that we had here today to Harvard Law School whenever we have the opportunity. So thank you all for coming, and I'm sure the congressman will be happy to stay for this. Thank you.